When I think of you, I think that you are the entrepreneur's entrepreneur. You know, there is this thing that, you know, what California represents to the US and what Silicon Valley represents to California. And I think that there are few entrepreneurs that they really represent Silicon Valley in a meaningful way. And if any of you search Julie's name, you'll see the number of companies that she's been a part of and she's built. It's just a phenomenal list, many of the brands that you know. And how did you become an entrepreneur? How did you get started?
Well, I mean, wait, but I really didn't start my first company till The RealReal. Other than that, I was CEO for hire. And the way I became a CEO, because I don't know if you know, the Valley's a little male-dominated, and there aren't that many female CEOs, is the company was failing, and I turned it around. And that's how a lot of women get their jobs. It's sort of like Alyssa, and not just in the Valley, but women CEOs do get their jobs in a time where, to be honest, a man wouldn't take the risk. And so that's there's a book that Julie Boorstin from CNBC wrote called How Women Lead, and it's full of these statistics. So when I brought that up last night, she goes, oh, the stats support that. And here she gave the stat, which I don't remember, but the stats support that. I think that's a key thing. My first job was at Clorox in brand management. I was the second youngest brand manager they ever hired, the second time they ever hired someone without a graduate degree. And I looked above me. This was a long time ago. Clorox is, I'm sure, a fine company now. But when I looked above me, there were no women, and there was no one I wanted to be. And I felt like I could stay there and play the game a little. And when I was 23, I was making $55,000 a year. This is in the 80s, early 80s. And I thought, boy, you know, you could get used to the money. And I don't want to do that. I wanted to do something bigger. And when a small company called Software Publishing called to recruit me, it was my former boss at Clorox's wife who had joined it. And it was technology. And it was the first company to actually do presentation graphics. But that came later. Harvard Graphics. I'm really dating myself, but that's okay. It was the PFS line and Harvard Graphics. And when I came down there, it was a real meritocracy at that time. I don't think I've ever had so much fun, and I never looked back. But, I mean, you're an entrepreneur. My father was an entrepreneur. I do think if you see someone succeed in that way, and he had a lot of joy in what he did, it's hard to take a job that doesn't give you that joy. And then at some point, you just like, okay, if I don't start this company, I'll never get another good job in my life. So, I mean, really, I think it's a spirit. I think it's a, for me personally, I'm not an easy person to be subordinated, so I have a little headstrong, even at a young age.
I think we would be bad employees.
We are. I think we decided we would be really bad employees. Yeah. But yes. So, I mean, honestly, and it's the best thing in the world. You know that, being an entrepreneur.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely.
And the worst thing, the best and the worst. Mostly
that,
better.
That is all true. Yes, I agree. I mean, there's a freedom aspect of it. There's that creativity that you can bring to life and all of that. But there's a stress, I mean, that never stops. It's always there, especially in the early days of a business. And you've been through a few of those early days. I mean, I know that you're a hired CEO, but when I think about a company like Pets.com, well, you joined that company so early that, I mean, you built that business. It wasn't built and then, them hiring a CEO.
Right. Now, when I joined, it was $40,000, and the guy was doing it out of his spare bedroom.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
I want to talk about, ask a few questions about some of these businesses. But before we do that, I want you to tell, because you keep starting new businesses or running new businesses. So tell us about your latest business, and then I'm going to go backward.
Okay. About almost a year ago, and we just launched in August. In our beta, but now we're out of beta. I launched a business with a medical doctor in LA who moved her career a long time ago, changed it to focus on nutrition first, educated herself, went back and got another physician nutrition degree, board certified from Tufts. She's a Tufts graduate school, medical school, and has spent her whole life trying to make sure people eat well so they have a great health span and getting them off drugs. She has a very interesting process as the testing got better, where you can do a biomarker test, which is just now at this point omegas and vitamin D. You combine that with a nutrigenomics test, which looks at how your body absorbs nutrients, and it's enlightening, and then an epigenetic test, which actually tells you how you're aging. Along with the health survey, we can use precision nutrition to pinpoint the key nutrients in your body and turn it into a new meal plan that you will need to prevent future illnesses. And it's all science-based. And what was interesting over lunch, I'm sitting with a friend of Payam's who's here, and she was talking about, not knowing what I was doing, how she had this undiagnosed illness and the doctors wanted to put her on medicine for depression. She knew she wasn't depressed. She had a significant vitamin D deficiency and that was not diagnosed. And my bet is, given the amount of vitamin D she's taking, her body doesn't absorb vitamin D, so she's taking an extraordinary amount. That would have come out in this testing. And so when you think about the power of the food that you eat, and how it can give you a much better health span. Food and exercise is important, but if you could only do one, I would say start making small changes in your diet, but now the tools are there to make it precision. So we just launched, the concierge doctors seem to like it and get it more than the consumers. I think it's too crazy out there in consumer land. So now we're developing corporate products and we'll go more into the medical, selling into the medical concierge doctors. But I encourage you all, go up, take it. And anyway, it's really important to me. Having a long health span is really important to me. And when I looked at my father, who wasn't young when he passed away, but he had a miserable end of life and he was about 100 pounds overweight. And he had diabetes. He went into, it's a series of complications with diabetes. So, and went into heart failure, but it started, he gained 100 pounds after a heart attack when he was 72. And from 72 to 86, his life deteriorated. And it didn't have to be that way. So, I mean, we're sort of on a mission, but it's a bigger mission than people who are ill. We're trying to prevent people from getting there.
I mean, a lot of us are building businesses and we're trying to figure out how our businesses can also have an element that could serve humanity, and the fact that the core business itself serves humanity, that must make you feel good.
Well, it's great, except we have a long way to go. I mean, when you look at the medical receipts now, diabetes and obesity-related illnesses surpassed other illnesses in terms of insurance building. Mm. And even though there's weight loss drugs, the insurance companies are saying they're too expensive and they're not going to keep people on them.
Yeah.
Even though it's lifestyle changing, the Ozempic category of drugs, but the insurance agencies are already turning down claims. So, yeah it's an epidemic.
Yeah. So the first time I heard about Julie, it was definitely over 20 years ago. I don't know exactly when. You know the date probably better because I didn't know you, but I heard about you because you just have sold Real.com for $100 million to Hollywood Video, which a lot of people here don't even know what was Hollywood Video. But tell us about that, because it was really interesting what you were telling me during lunch.
Oh, this is great. This just shows, all right.
What year was it that you sold that company?
That was 98? I want to say 96.
Oh, okay.
All right, a long time ago. But Real.com was the first site to sell movies online. This is before, we weren't renting movies, and Netflix wasn't in existence. So during our tenure, movies went to the DVD from the big cassette, so literally that long ago. We got the company up to about $50 million even back then, but we only sold the movies on the internet. And Hollywood Video and Blockbuster Video both came courting. They wanted to buy the company. Hollywood wanted to buy it because they thought by buying it, they would kill the internet distribution of movies. And in case you're wondering where Hollywood is, they've been gone a lot longer than Blockbuster. So it just shows you how humorous that is. And right when the sale went through, Reed Hastings called and asked for a meeting. And I didn't have a non-compete.
Reed Hastings, the founder of Netflix.
Oh, sorry. Reed Hastings is the founder of Netflix. And he said, he's like, why didn't you guys ever go into rental? And I said, well, it was a different, he was already in renting DVDs. I said, it was a different software. It would have taken us a long time to code it and put that infrastructure. And he said, well, how long do you think I have? And I said, before they catch up. I said, 20 years? I don't know. And of course, they're gone. So it just shows the power of reinvention. And it also shows a good entrepreneur was paranoid. So, you know, both things. Yeah. But yeah, I'm that old, Payam. So there you go.
No. You know, you were just talking about, we'll get there because talking about being old, which I don't feel old and I don't think you feel old, but Silicon Valley does. And talking about funding. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Right. So then when I got to know you a little bit better when you were running a company called, what's it called, Bellamax?
Yes.
Yes. But at about that time, you know, I got to know you a little bit better, and then you started the RealReal, which, truth be told, she called me, I don't know why, but she did, even though she didn't need it because she has many sources of capital. But I end up investing in the RealReal at a $2 million valuation.
Yeah, wait. I wanted a friendly investor who understood entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
Because it really was at the early friends and family. And the worst thing an entrepreneur can do is bring on investors who don't understand the entrepreneurial process, because it's a ride. It's a lot of ups and downs. Things can, you know, some days more things go wrong than right. A lot of days, but you got to. So it's really critical early stage.
Right.
So yes, I called one of the best entrepreneurs I know.
Thank you.
And he wrote a check. And yes.
At $2 million valuation, and the value of this business peaked at $2.1 billion ultimately. So, you know, twice unicorn.
Yes.
And that's tell us about that business. Where did the idea come from? Because a lot of people have heard of the RealReal. Maybe they have. I saw somebody who said that they had bought their pants from the RealReal here.
Thank you very
much. Oh, there she is. So, okay. So tell us about that and where the idea came from.
So, after I ran pets.com, the Valley, I was sort of a pariah, and I can use those words, no one else can, but it was true, because they're like, oh, she crashed the internet, and the little puppet is still being used whenever they talk about the dot-com explosion, the dot-com bombs, they bring up the puppet.
So that's about pets.com that Julie took public in, you know, during the dot-com, right before the dot-com bubble, and that company just went up like crazy, did really well, and then ultimately you shut it down.
I did shut it down because I couldn't get financing, because all the secondary financing closed for business to consumer, which were in another one of those cycles, by the way. So all the funding went out. I knew I needed to raise more capital, and I was at a deciding point, run the company bankruptcy or shut down a public company that still had capital and distribute to the shareholders. I chose the latter. I probably wouldn't do that choice again. But anyway, the press were all over it. It's crazy. Whoever would buy pet food online? This was the dumbest idea. Of course it was going to fail. I don't know if anyone uses Chewy.com here. But they're a wonderful company, but they're not nearly as good as Pets was. And all I'd say about that is timing is everything. But that was a big failure. And after that, I really got offered.
By the way, in New York, every time FedEx trucks show up and they empty all the boxes, literally a third are Chewy boxes.
There you go.
Yes, that's a huge business. But sorry,
well, it's a huge category.
Yes.
People love their pets. And anyway, the next phase was a recruiter, Mr. Love was his name, told me that I was over in the Valley. I'd never get another gig. And so then I thought, okay, I've got two choices. Start my own business for the first time ever, not be a gun to hire, or move to Arizona and become a yoga teacher. And I know yoga is a popular thing and it's good for people, but for me, it felt like a cult, so I hate yoga. I'm just saying, if you love it, I can honor that. And I really don't like Arizona. But I've grown to like Arizona and I've grown to appreciate yoga, but I was thinking, like, what's the worst case alternative for me? Like, my other path is this other one, for some reason. which spurred me. And then I worked with some people and had a little mini summit at my house, and we mapped out everything Amazon could and couldn't do. And we made projections for Amazon for the next 5 years. And one of the spaces was luxury that they couldn't do. And by the way, they still can't do it. And I thought, okay, that was in my head. I had no ideas. I had categories where they couldn't compete because I knew I wanted to get back into commerce. And then I was shopping with a girlfriend, and she went into a beautiful boutique. In the back of the store was a little bit of consignment, and that's where she shopped. And I'd never seen that behavior from her in my life. And I went after that. I'm like, why have you never shopped at a consignment store? I'd never do it. Would you ever shop at eBay? Are you crazy? Too many fakes. I'm like, you just bought consignment. She goes, I don't look at it this way. It's a beautiful store. I trust the owner. I got Louis Vuitton, Gucci, Prada at a great deal. And I went home that night. I'm like, that's it. And I researched the category, wrote a business plan, tried to recruit the shop owner to be my co-partner. But by the time she got back to me, I had Payam's money.
It wasn't that much money.
But you know what I mean. We had starting seed money, of which he was one. We had a name. We were incorporated. We had seed money. I was rolling. And I said, you know, I don't think you can move as fast, because by the time we could find a date that worked for her, it was 3.5 months later, and I was already executing. And then it took a year for me to raise institutional money. So it really was friends and family money for the first year. And I spent that first year proving out the business model. We did $10 million the first year. So proving out the business model, working on it, and setting it up for a bigger success with VCs. Because, can I give them the stats?
Yep, go for it.
Because then women only got about 3% of all financing. And I was also an old woman because I was 52. So you have a 52-year-old woman trying to get a portion of that 3% in Silicon Valley. So I knew the odds were against me. Even though I had a business that went from zero to $10 million with basically, I think I only had brought in like $1.1 million in financing. By the way, the numbers now are below 2%. So it's gotten worse, not better. It sounds familiar to what we heard about the money manager market this morning. So then I just ran and executed as fast as I could. Yes, so that was the beginning. It started in my kitchen. Then it went to a really bad strip mall in San Rafael, California. It was only bad because it was dangerous at night and it smelled like bacon in the morning. Because there was that little coffee shop next door that also sold
sandwiches.
I think
that's where you had there was a time that we came that you had stuff, you know, outside that you were actually, you know, doing a clearinghouse.
Yep. We were like, we got to move this product. And also, so we did real in-person, like, shopping for a while, and that exposed people to the quality of the product. But it was
you have not selected easy businesses along the way, because I mean these are complicated businesses to build, even like more complicated than average e-commerce, because when you have only one of every item, I mean it's just a crazy amount of SKUs that you have to worry about.
That's right. I mean, when I left, you're getting about 700,000, over 700,000 unique SKUs. So I left about 18 months ago, in every month. Wow. So that's a lot. But so yeah, you had to reverse engineer all the code. You had to have special code, but that's a huge moat. It's a huge moat, and a lot of it's driven by AI and machine learning once it gets in, but it's still heavily dependent on people. I think there were about 1.6 million square feet in warehouse space. And it's warehouse space that you're bringing in product, but you're also turning it within a 90-day period. Yeah, it wasn't easy, but that made it also a great business to build a moat. Because when, I mean, this is my, I know we've got entrepreneurs in the crowd. My basic truth about being an entrepreneur, and it's proven out, if you have a good idea, it's up there. It's out there in the atmosphere, and you've accessed it somehow, which means if you accessed it, 7 to 10 other people have accessed it, and then it becomes who can execute fast and run hard. When we got funded in the resale market, 6 other businesses got funded the first year. And I think some of them at a higher valuation. And it sort of whittled its way down to 3. Because they went out of business. One was ThredUp, one was Poshmark, and one was The RealReal. But at one time, we all got funded the same year, and we all got the same amount of money. So, you know, and that's the last place you want to be in that kind of overly funded, crazy market, which, by the way, pets.com, when they got funded, six other pet sites got funded.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because,
you know, because venture capital people tend to be a little lemming-like, so if one person does it, like, it's got to be a great idea.
And then when they stop funding, they stop funding all at the same time.
Yeah, it's the same way. Yeah.
I have known you for, I don't know how many years,
plus.
But 15 plus years. And one thing about you that definitely stands out is the energy you always have. Every time I see you, I leave very energized. You're so excited about what you're working on now. And there is that. So what keeps you going? What gives you that energy that you keep, you know, wanting to, you know, cover new territory?
All right, so full disclosure, I'm like this every, like, I get up in the morning, I'm like, what a great day.
I know, I see your post, it's like sunrise, sunset.
I'm like, I'm so annoying. I think it's just, I think if I didn't channel that energy in the business, I would bug everyone.
What I saw at lunch that really inspired me and I loved was that, to see that the youth were at your table.
No, I went to their table.
Oh, you went there? Okay, even better.
Yeah, that's...
But that is really cool because, I mean, I know that my own daughters, you know, they know about your story, they know about your, you know, the businesses that you've started, and it really excites them. And, you know, I've got, you know, Guya and I have two daughters, and it's great to have women role models
It's so important. So. I mean, honestly, I was lucky to meet one of my role models, but when I was growing up, women, I didn't see any women working at all. And my role model then, I had like three, but one was Gloria Steinem, who I spent a couple of days with. The other one is Nancy Drew, who's a fictional character. She was a great detective in California, riding through the Sierras in a little cool sports car. I'm like, I love Nancy Drew. I want to be Nancy Drew. And the last who I also met was Jane Goodall. She was another role model for me.
Do you have any regrets? What would you have done differently?
You know, I have to say, this is also, I think this, again, in the book, Julia said, I brought this up last night. She said it's statistically proven. I wish I would have started my own company earlier. I had a lot of good ideas, and I sort of was backed into a corner before I did. And women tend to think they have to know a lot more before they start the company than men do. They're like, well, I'm still learning. Oh, I've still got something more to learn. And I had that gene, you know, pretty aggressively. And then I'm like, okay, well, I don't really have an option, and I think it's time for me to learn for myself. But so I wish I would have just leapt off the cliff earlier, because I had a lot of ideas, some which I saw executed and done well. And, you know, I waited, but that's the downside. The good thing is it's never too late. But, you know, I just wish I would have done it earlier. I wish I would have gotten over that. It wasn't even a fear of failure. It was a feeling like I still had this learning gap.
Yeah.
And I didn't have other female entrepreneurs around me. I think if I would have, they would have talked. They would have said, "No, just do it." I know these men; they just do it. They haven't learned anything either, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I have to say that it did help that my father started his own business and loved
it
every day.
Right.
You know, so that I think if it's that close, and you see their passion and how happy they are, you're like, I want some of that when I grow up.
That's good. Why did you leave the RealReal, and what made you know it was time to close that chapter?
So I left the RealReal because I did not like the board. And I was 65 years old, and sadly, I thought that the direction they wanted the company they were getting heavy-handed, I thought would ruin the company. That's a true story. Now, having said that, I wanted to make sure that Rati Levesque, who's running it, would be there at least to keep the wheels on and keep it going. And I wanted.
And she's been there since the beginning.
She was my employee number one.
Yeah.
She's a rock star, and I knew if she was going to sign up to keep it going, and the board would let her, that it would be great. And she's still there, and as long as she's there, the company will be in good hands. But here's what happened. Here's what happens when you get older. You don't really put up with a lot of stuff that you know is wrong. And the other thing is, I had started this other business during COVID, or at least talked to my now co-founder, analyzed the whole market, felt like I could really get another business going that I was excited about. And then I thought, I can either spend time working with these people who I didn't enjoy, and it was a new board. This is the other thing, the company was public. I had to replace my board. My original board were venture capital people, and you can hear a lot of negative things about it, but actually they're great board members, especially when they made money. But they're really great. But honestly, VC people understand entrepreneurs, and if you pick the right partners, I had really great ones, but they all exited after, except for one investor who didn't get his money out and had an undue influence. Mm-hmm. And then I replaced my board members that had exited with people that didn't understand entrepreneurs. So that was a key lesson. Mm. They were corporate people that didn't understand the difference between a high growth company, because the company was still growing fast, and a no growth company. They didn't understand collaboration, which at most tech companies and most great companies are built with a collaborative model versus a hierarchical model. Their model set was hierarchical. But I think it was like, I wanted to do this other business, so it was time, but also I wasn't willing to work in an environment I thought would be really unhealthy.
Yeah.
And a battle.
No, it makes sense. I mean,
I also had a great person lined up. So it was like all three things came together.
I mean, I left the company I founded shortly after the IPO because of the challenges with the board. And that's a path that you go, like when you take a company public, you're no longer in control. So if things go well, great. But if there are challenges and the board is not the right board, it may not make sense to stick around anymore.
No, and you know, when we talked about values at lunch, I mean, I have to say, I'm completely a straight shooter. I value authenticity. I value discussion of hard problems without, because I don't take them personally, collaboratively. Anyone that's playing politics or deceiving or making false statements, I can't.
Sure.
You know, so it really comes down to who do you want to work with and do you share the values?
Makes sense. So, as you know, this conference is about how can we elevate business to serve humanity? So do you think that the RealReal, well, I can see how your new business is absolutely serving humanity and will be. Do you think the RealReal served humanity? I think it did, but I want to hear from you.
No, absolutely it did. So one of the things that people didn't know, and I wish we did as good a job as we could, but the fashion industry is the number three polluter in the world. And really, it's this addiction to fast fashion, and it goes into landfills. Materials don't break down for 60 to 70 years. Plastics, most fabric has high plastic content. So we are literally choking the planet and putting and leaching in really harmful chemicals. And now with Shein, which is the Chinese company that's, I don't know, but I think it's the number one retailer, they come out with something like 275 different fashion styles a year. Think about that and think about the workforce, and it's all cheap. It gets worn, it gets ruined, it's in a landfill. The RealReal really promoted recirculating goods, and that is actually the future to buy, and we made it cool. And we did that on purpose. It was self-serving because obviously if we make it cool, we have a business. But secondarily, if people think it's a cool thing to buy used things, they're gonna buy used things. And then if you resell them, again, keeping that circular economy going was really, really important. And we work with data scientists to quantify the impact of recirculating a good versus buying new. And so it was a small movement, but it started as a small movement. We made some inroads, but then you see something like Shein take off, and you're like, wow, it's really dangerous. I mean, fashion is sort of a silent polluter. You're never going to hear companies talk about it, but it's overproduction and it's also bad use. 60% of the things produced in the fast fashion world never get sold.
Wow.
So and then you combine that with
60%.
60.
Wow.
And when you combine that with what happens to those things, Europe now at least has a no burn law. The U.S. does not, and nor do the developing countries. So then they either burn it or they put it in a landfill. And then what is consumed, if it breaks down, it goes back in a landfill. And if you search this now, there are countries in coastal Africa where the whole fishing industry is gone because the water, everyone's shipping their product to them and it's just washing up everywhere. Mm-hmm. So they've lost their ability to grow things, they can't fish, and so guess what they're doing? They're taking the used clothes and trying to turn it into something else, but it is a big, big problem. So the RealReal did bring that to the forefront. We were the first one. We tried to do it with the fashion industry, not shaming the fashion industry. But that was a really good thing to do. So yes, it was a luxury brand, but luxury brands can be recirculated 10, 20, 30 times. And if you buy it already on the RealReal, you can resell it. But it's a serious problem. We had lobbied Washington. We started turning on some lights there. Let alone, I mean, you should hear the stories I heard from major companies behind the scenes at fairs like the Copenhagen Fashion Summit, which deals with sustainability, talking about how people had to do bargains with the Taliban to use their rivers because the dyes were too poisonous.
Oh, wow.
I mean,
wow.
This is not a trivial thing that happens, let alone the workforce. If you buy a $20 garment, you got me going. If you buy a $20 garment from Shein, and what's happened to that garment is they probably paid the staff 50 cents, and they probably live there. They built a compound. These people never leave. And the wages are horrific. So, I mean, it's all bad.
Yeah.
You know, so we can either consume less, never works, or get people to think about recirculating what they have.
Wow. I mean, that's kind of what sold me on the idea, and I love the idea from day one. Julie, it's just fabulous to have you.
Thank you, everybody. It's an honor.
As a member of this community, thank you so much.
Think of sharing what you know.